You pull out your message notes and open your Bibles to Matthew chapter 5. Today, we're in part 3 of the series on Jesus' 8 keys to living a blessed life. They're often called the Beatitudes. They're the first 8 verses of the most important sermon ever preached on planet Earth, the Sermon on the Mount. In Matthew chapter 5, verse 5, Jesus says this, the third key to God's blessing on your life. God blesses those who are gentle. Look at that. God blesses those who are gentle. And then here's the promise. The whole earth will belong to them. Are you kidding me? That's about the most extravagant statement ever made. The whole earth will belong to anybody who's gentle. Do I really believe that? Well, I wouldn't, except Jesus said it. And Jesus doesn't lie. Jesus said, I am the truth. Not I have the truth, I teach the truth, I point the truth, I am the truth. So if Jesus says, God blesses those who are gentle, the whole earth will belong to them, guess what? I believe that. He's saying somehow locked up in this third key of blessing is the key that when you learn what it really means to be gentle, the world's yours. I mean, it's your apple. You're in charge. It's not driving you, you're driving it. Now, in our hard-driving, ego-driven, market-driven culture, you don't hear a whole lot about gentleness. And the reason why is we don't understand what it really means to be gentle. We think gentleness means weakness. And God says, absolutely not. The gentle are the strongest people on the planet, and the earth will be theirs. It's the weak people who are arrogant. It's the weak people who are prideful. It's the weak people who are pushy and rude and mean and gossip. Those are weak people. He said, the truly strong people in life are the gentle, and the world will be theirs. Now, I want you to write down a definition. This is not the first fill-in, so don't put it on that line. You're just gonna have to write it somewhere else on the outline. But let me give you a true definition of gentleness. It's here on the screen. Gentleness is strength under control. Gentleness, the Bible teaches, real gentleness, is not weakness, but rather it's strength under control. A gentle person does not overreact. A gentle person is not driven by their own emotions. A gentle person is not someone who just is so moody and anything can let them fly off the handle. A gentle person is strength under control. The Greek word in the Bible for gentleness is the word prates, prates. In the old translations of the Bible in English, it is translated as the word meek, meek. Now, nobody uses that word anymore because meek has become a synonym for weak, and gentleness or prates is anything but weak. In fact, the word prates or gentleness in the Bible was actually used to refer to a wild stallion that had been tamed. If you go out into the fields or in the hills and you find a wild stallion who's strong and unbridled and they have enormous strength and they could kick you and kill you pretty quickly, but if you bring that stallion back and you tame it, then the strength is brought under control. The strength is bottled up for the master's use and now it's useful. A tamed horse is no less strong than a wild horse. It has just as much strength, it can go just as fast. But a tamed horse, a prates horse, a meek horse, a gentle horse is one that it is strength under control, it is bottled up for the master's use. And when you learn true gentleness as a man of God, when you learn true gentleness as a woman of God, it doesn't mean you're weak, it doesn't mean you're a doormat, it doesn't mean you're any of those things that you might think meekness or gentleness means. It means you're not overreacting. You're in control of your emotions and you have strength under control. Now today, I want us to look at the strength of gentleness, this third key to being blessed by God in your life. And specifically, I want to give you eight benefits, what the Bible says, eight benefits of learning gentleness, so that this week you'll actually begin to work on this quality in your life. Because once you understand what this quality will do in your life, you're going to go, I want to be a gentle man, or I want to be a gentle woman, because it brings so many blessings in your life. I'm going to give you eight. So we're going to have to write quick, take notes real quick. Number one, let's get right into it. How learning to be gentle will bless your life. Number one, the Bible teaches gentleness diffuses conflict. Gentleness diffuses conflict. It de-escalates anger. It curbs anger. It diffuses the time bomb in any relationship that's about to explode. Gentleness is an antidote to anger. The Bible says in Proverbs 15, verse 1, a gentle answer turns away wrath, but a harsh word stirs up anger. I don't know if you've noticed this or not, but it is a tendency of human beings. You and I tend to mimic the emotions of people across from us. And the reason we do this is because there's created in your brains what are now, we now know about this, we didn't even know about this years ago. In your brain are things called mirror neurons in your brain. And mirror neurons allows you to sympathize and also allow you to mirror back what other people feel. So for instance, if somebody gets angry at you, you get angry back. If somebody gets upset, you get upset back. If somebody's really depressed, you hang around them long enough, you get depressed. On the other hand, if somebody's energetic, you get energetic. That's part of the system. Now, the Bible says a gentle answer turns away wrath, but a harsh word stirs up anger. Let me give you a little tip that'll save you a lot of problems and a lot of heartache and a lot of conflict in your life. When other people raise their voice, you lower yours. That simple tip will save you from an enormous amount of conflict in your marriage, in your parenting, in your friendships, and at work. When other people raise your voice, you need to learn to automatically lower yours. That's called strength under control. See, what happens is usually when somebody raises their voice against you, you raise your voice back, and then they raise their voice higher, and you raise your voice higher, and pretty soon it's way escalated way up here. That means you're out of control of your emotions. Strength under control, gentleness means that when they raise their emotions, you lower yours. And you're not gonna mimic and mock them. Now, here's a good verse you're gonna need someday. Maybe some of you need it this week. Ecclesiastes 10:4. If your boss is angry with you, don't quit. If your boss is angry with you, don't quit. A quiet, gentle spirit can overcome even great mistakes. You see, when your boss rips one on you and just lets it rip and just kind of vomits on you, and really gets mad at you, you need to first realize it may not be anything, have anything to do with you. They may have just got a bad phone call. They may be receiving pressure from their boss. They may have a bad situation at home. They may just ate a bad pizza. It could be any number of things. And now they're turning to the person closest to them, which is somebody who works for them, and they just kind of vent on you. And a lot of times that has nothing to do with you. And he says, when your boss gets angry at you, A, don't get angry back, but B, don't walk away either. Just hang in there, because it says a gentle, quiet spirit can overcome even great mistakes. Number two, gentleness not only diffuses anger, gentleness, this is a big one, disarms critics. It disarms critics. Now, the more successful you are in life, the more critics you're gonna have. If you don't do anything with your life, nobody's gonna criticize you. The only way to not be criticized, do nothing, say nothing, be nothing. But if you actually stand for something, instead of falling for anything, you're gonna be criticized. And the more successful you are, the more criticized you are. And the more well-known you are, the more criticized you're going to be. Now, how do you handle the critics in your life? The people who gossip against you at school, at work, in your neighborhood, the people who malign you, who say bad things against you. Here's the point. When you respond in gentleness, it disarms your critics. Why? It actually disappoints them. Because when somebody criticizes you on social media, they're trolling, friends. They're trolling. They want to hook you. And they want you, and they're expecting you to get mad back. They're expecting you. And they want you to be defensive, and they want you to get angry. Now, let me explain the psychology behind this. There is actually an anger addiction that is as real as any other addiction. Some people are addicted to the feeling of anger. It's the only way they feel alive. And they live in such a depressed state. They're living in so much depression in their life. The only way they can actually feel good or feel alive or feel energetic is to get mad at somebody. Those people are always looking for a fight. Do you know who I'm talking about? Don't look at them. But you know who they are. Maybe you had a parent like that. You know, maybe you married somebody like that. Maybe you had a boyfriend like that. And it's just like, why are you looking for a fight? Because some people actually don't feel very good until they get angry. And when they get angry, then what happens is it energizes them and they feel a whole lot better. Does that make sense? So you cannot let them pull you in, because somebody's going to say something to you on Instagram or Google Plus or Facebook or something, Twitter or something, and if you respond, they go, hooked them. Now I'm just going to reel them in. And they feel so good because they love getting in a fight. Normal people don't love getting in a fight, but some people do. Now, they're trying to hook you. What do you do in those situations? 1 Corinthians 4:13, Paul says, here's what he does. We respond gently when evil things are said about us. In other words, we don't retaliate. We don't get back. You see, if somebody hurts you, that puts them below you. If you get even, it puts you even. But if you respond gently, it actually puts you morally superior to them. And Paul says, we respond gently even when evil things are said about us. Titus 2:8 says this, your conversation should be so sensible. In other words, it's gentle, it's kind, it's sensitive and sensible, that anyone who wants to argue, in other words, with you, will be ashamed because there won't be anything to criticize in anything you say. Did you know that as your pastor, I am forbidden by God to get into arguments? There are multiple passages in the scripture that says a pastor must never argue. Now, I know a lot of pastors who do, and they just violate that scripture. But the Bible says a pastor should never get caught, brought into a heated argument or debate. It says, I am commanded by God to be gentle in every situation. So this is a quality I've had to learn in ministry. Let me show you a verse. It's up here on the screen. 2 Timothy 2:25, this is one of many. It says, and the Lord's servant, it's talking about pastors. It gives the qualifications for being a pastor. And it says, one of them is, the Lord's servant must never quarrel. Look at that. I am not allowed to quarrel, according to the Bible. Instead, he must be kind and gentle with everyone he agrees with. No, he must be kind and gentle with everyone in his political party. No, it doesn't say that. He must be kind and gentle with everyone who is a Christian. No, it doesn't say that. It says with everyone. Does that include other religions? Yes. Includes atheists? Yes. People with a lifestyle I disagree with? Yes. I am to be kind and gentle with everybody. I am forbidden to quarrel with anybody. It says they must be able to teach effectively, a pastor, and they must be patient with difficult people. That means you. then it says, those who oppose him, he must gently instruct. Gently, there's that word gentle. He must gently instruct in the hope that God will grant them repentance, leading them to know the truth. I don't know if you've noticed this or not, but I get criticized every once in a while. In fact, all the time. And most of it's just total nonsense. It makes no sense at all. And when I read it, I go, why would they criticize me for that? That's not true. I know the stuff they should criticize me. They should ask me. And then they could criticize the real things that I'm worthy of criticism about. But I am not allowed to retaliate in any way. It's why I never, ever, ever fight back with critics. Never. I just don't do it. Why? The Bible says gentleness disarms critics. And so I constantly ask God for a tough skin and a tender heart. And that's what you need to do. You need to say, God, give me a tough skin. So when people say stuff about me, it just rolls off my back. I don't let it bother me. But I have a tender heart. You don't want a tough heart. You want a tender heart and a tough skin. What's really funny is because God says God blesses those who are gentle, the whole earth belongs to them. Some of my biggest critics have actually become some of my best friends because I would not retaliate. I only responded in gentleness. There's a well-known pastor who's been on the radio for years and years and years, and he's just criticized me for 35 years. I don't think he's ever read anything that I've written or even visited Saddleback Church, so he's just heard it all secondhand. And he's criticized, and in 34 years, I have refused to ever say one single thing negative about that guy. I just won't do it. In fact, the other day, he went on a recent rampage and was talking about stuff that just wasn't right. And somebody on Twitter said, Pastor Rick, have you seen what Pastor so-and-so has said about you? Are you gonna respond to it? And I wrote back on Twitter these words. What, and I mentioned that guy's name, what that guy thinks about me in no way controls my response to him, and I have nothing but total respect for his ministry. That's called gentleness. That's called strength under control. And you know what's interesting is that guy, three of that guy's staff have actually come down to Saddleback in the last couple weeks asking our staff to help them get organized. So I don't think he knows that we're mentoring his staff. So don't tell him. Okay. Gentleness diffuses conflict. Gentleness disarms critics. Here's a real important one. Gentleness is persuasive. The Bible says gentleness is persuasive. Now, this is extremely important if you happen to make a career in sales. If you're a salesman, a saleswoman, you have to sell a product or a service, you definitely need to learn gentleness. Why? Because the hard sell no longer works. It used to be the way you got people's attention in the world was to be the loudest advertisement. And all you had to do was be loud and fast and hard and strong, and people would go, okay, I'll buy a vacuum cleaner. You know, okay, I'll buy your computer. I'll buy your car. None of that works anymore. I mean, you know, there were these guys used to be on TV to sell cars, and they talked real loud and real fast. Hi, my name's Cal Worthington, and my dog Spot. And they start to go see Cal. And you need to buy this right now. Only $99.95. But wait, we'll throw in the Ginzu knife. But wait, and then you know, and you're going, not a chance. Am I going to go see that guy? In fact, when somebody comes on really hard and really forceful, what's your automatic reaction? Back off. No way am I buying anything from that person. Today, the hard sell no longer works. In fact, advertising doesn't work anymore. What works is gentleness. And so you get, you know what? Most of the stuff you buy today, you don't buy it because somebody's giving you a hard sales pitch. You buy it because somebody recommended it. And we go, oh, what are my friends? What car are they buying? What movies are they seeing? What restaurants are they going to? And it is recommendations. Why? Because that's a gentle approach. It's far more persuasive. Let me show you some verses. Proverbs 25, verse 15 says, gentle speech can break down rigid defenses. So you want to convince your girlfriend, your boyfriend, your husband, your wife, your parents to do something? Not the hard sell. That's not going to work. Gentle speech breaks down rigid defenses. The New Century Version says a gentle word can get through to the hard-headed. And so if you're a parent, screaming at your child never works. Never works. You never discipline in anger, and you never discipline in frustration. You always discipline in love, and you do it gently, because screaming never works. All it does is create fear and resentment in the person you're screaming at. And they get defensive, and they put it up. You know, if I want to persuade you to live more for Jesus Christ, I must do it in a gentle way. See, I could stand up here every Sunday evening and say, let me tell you all the things you're doing wrong. And what would you do? You just build an emotional barrier, say, forget Rick. And you probably stop coming. You go, you wouldn't say, hey, let's go to Saddleback Sunday night and have Rick tell us what bad people we are. That doesn't work. It doesn't work in the pulpit. It doesn't work in the house. It doesn't work as a teacher. Nagging never works. But gentleness is persuasive. A gentle word can get through to the hard-headed. You say it gently. Look at this verse. I love it in the Contemporary English Version. It says, patience and gentle talk can convince a ruler and overcome any problem. That's what the Bible says. Now leave that verse up there for a minute. See that word ruler? Let me give you a little tip on Bible study. Anytime you see the word ruler in the Bible, you translate it boss, manager, supervisor. Because we don't have rulers today. We're in a democracy. We don't have kings, we don't have queens, we don't have lords and ladies and counts and vassals. We don't have kings and rulers. Nobody rules over you, but everybody has a boss. And we all have to work under supervision at different times in our life. So anytime you see the word ruler or king in the Bible, just translate it, CEO, boss, manager, the supervisor over me. Patience and gentle talk can convince your supervisor and overcome any problem. Why? Because gentleness is persuasive. Look at the next verse. The Bible says in Proverbs 16:21, a wise, mature person is known for understanding. The more pleasant his words, the more persuasive he is. Now, circle the word pleasant and circle the word persuasive and draw a line between them. Because if you want to be persuasive, if you want to persuade people of your idea, your product, your service, your faith, or anything else, you must be pleasant. Pleasant. The more pleasant his words, the more persuasive he is. Now, this is the mark of maturity. Wise, mature people are pleasant. Fools and idiots are rude. Fools and idiots are rude. They're crass, they're crude, they're not pleasant, they're unpleasant. And they speak in rude, crude ways. The more mature, the more wise you are, the more pleasant, the more positive your speech is gonna be. If your speech is negative, 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 guess what? You're not that smart. You're not wise, and you certainly aren't mature, because the more wise and mature you are, the more pleasant your words are. I want you to write this down. In fact, you can tweet this one. I'm never persuasive when I'm abrasive. Write that one down, or tweet it right now. I'm never persuasive when I'm abrasive. When you are abrasive in your language, you actually self-defeat yourself. Because all the things you want don't happen because you are being abrasive rather than being persuasive. Gentleness is persuasive. Number four, this is a really big one, particularly if you're looking for a husband or wife. Number four, gentleness is attractive. The Bible says if you want to be more attractive, you need to learn to be more gentle in your life. Now, this is true in both men and in women. Now, one of the laws of life is I attract what I am. I don't attract what I want, I attract what I am. If you want to attract a godly man, you have to be a godly woman. If you want to attract a godly woman, you have to be a godly man. You can't be some rude dude in a crude mood and say, I really want one of those good women. No, you will attract what you are. And so gentleness attracts gentleness, and godliness attracts godliness. Now, since we've got a bunch of singles in this service, for some guys, let me show you this. 1 Timothy 6:11, here on the screen. I'm going to give you a verse for guys and a verse for gals. 1 Timothy 6:11, as a man of God, and I want all of you guys to be men of God, as a man of God, pursue what God approves of. And then he gives you the five marks of a godly man. This is Paul talking to Timothy. He's mentoring his son in the ministry. He says, pursue what God approves of. And here are the five things that make a godly man. Godliness, faith, love, endurance, and oh, by the way, gentleness. Gentleness. Now he says, God approves of godliness. What is godliness? It means I'm trying to let Jesus live through me. I want to be like God. I want to be like Christ. I want to be Christ-like. That's godliness. And then he says, another mark of a man of God is faith. I trust God in every area of my life. Another mark of a man of God is love. You're loving. You're unselfish. Another mark of a man of God is endurance. You don't give up. You don't quit. You have endurance. You have diligence. You have determination. And then one of the marks of a man of God is gentleness. That is strength under control, and that is attractive. Now, I don't want to belabor this point, but for you single guys, I want to give you a little advice tonight, because Dr. Love is in the house. All right? Dr. Ricky Love, here he is. Guys, if you want to attract a good woman, you need to do what Boaz did. Who? Boaz. Where is he? In the Old Testament. Where is it? Look it up. No, I'll tell you. Boaz is in the story of Ruth, named after her in the book of Ruth. Now, here's the story of Boaz. Boaz is a young businessman, and he is pretty successful. And he's got a wheat farm, and he's doing a good job, and he's got his business interest going pretty good. And one day he looks out on his field, and he sees some stragglers taking wheat from his crop. Now, he'd already harvested the crop, but there's a little left over, and a lot of times homeless people or very poor people would go out into the fields that had already been harvested and find the little extra. This is called gleaning. And he looks out and he sees one of these people is a woman named Ruth. And she's very, very poor because her husband has died. She's a widow. She's young, but her husband has died. And Ruth decides, I'm going to take care of my aged mother-in-law. My husband has died. She has no legal responsibility to take care of her mother-in-law. But she goes, this is what God would want me to do. So I'm going to take care of my aged mother-in-law, even though my young husband has died. And so she's out here picking grains in the fields in Boaz's field. Now, Boaz could have gone out. He could have been rude. He could have been ruthless. He could have been demanding. And he could have said, get off my property. This is my property. You don't have any right to be harvesting my grain. It's my grain. And if I want to leave it out there, I can. But he was not rude. He was not ruthless. He was not crude. In fact, he was gentle with Ruth. And not only does he allow her to pick, he says, I got enough. Let her pick some grain on my crops. Go ahead and let her do it. He then commends her. He compliments Ruth for taking care of her aged mother-in-law. And he compliments her. And he's very kind, and if you read the whole story, he's very gentle with this total stranger. And so then Ruth responds this way. In Ruth chapter 2, verse 13 and 14, Ruth said to Boaz, you're very kind to me. You have made me feel better. You have made me feel better by speaking gently to me. Pause. Guys, a woman always feels better when you speak gently to her. When you're not in a hurry, when you're not rushing, you're not rude, you're not forceful, a woman always feels better when you speak gently to her. You have made me feel better by speaking gently to me. And so it's going good. So Boaz invites her out to lunch. And then at lunchtime, Boaz says to Ruth, come, Have a piece of bread with me and dip it in the sauce. Now, you thought fondue was Swedish. 2,000 years before anybody said the word fondue, Boaz is dipping in the sauce with Ruth. And it says, then Boaz passed her some roasted grain to eat, a little granola, and she ate it until she was satisfied, and she still had food left over. He gives her a doggy bag. Now, this is a good thing. He's being kind. He's being gentle. Now, here's an interesting thing. Out of that simple incident, because he was kind and because he was gentle, they end up becoming an item, falling in love, and getting married. Now, why is that story even in the Bible? Because Ruth was not even Jewish. And it was illegal for a Jewish man, Boaz, to marry a non-Jewish woman. But he did, and God had a plan in it. And in Matthew chapter 1, where it gives the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the Messiah, there are four women mentioned in that genealogy, and one of them is not even Jewish. Her name is Ruth. And God used that marriage as one of the marriages to bring the Messiah into the world. In fact, Ruth had a grandson, and his name was King David. King David. And it all happened because Boaz was gentle with a woman he didn't even know. And here's the point. If Boaz had been ruthless, he would have been ruthless. I've waited all week to share that with you. Okay? Come on, that's pretty good, right? Okay? If Boaz had been ruthless, he would have been ruthless. And all of that history would not have happened. But it all started with him just being gentle. Would you write this down? Gentlemen are gentlemen. Gentlemen are gentlemen. The way you become a gentleman is by being gentle. Now, that's for the guys. Let me talk to you women for just a minute. Gentleness is attractive, not just on a gentleman, on a man, but gentleness is attractive in women too. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 4 says this. Talking to women. You should be known for the beauty that comes from within. The unfading beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit, which is so precious to God. Now, I want you to circle the word unfading. God says, I want you to focus on unfading beauty. I hate to tell you this, ladies, but your beauty is gonna fade. In fact, all men and all women, our beauty fades. Some of us, our beauty started fading about year one. We were cute as babies. But he says, there's an unfading beauty that is attractive. And what is that unfading beauty that is attractive? The beauty of a gentle spirit. Gentleness is attractive. Number five, the fifth reason why you want to learn this quality in your life is that gentleness communicates love. Gentleness communicates love. It diffuses conflict. It disarms critics. It's persuasive, it's attractive, and gentleness communicates love. Guys, those of you who are husbands and are married, the quickest way to improve your marriage, the quickest way to improve your marriage is to start talking to your wife more gently. It'll do wonders if you'll begin to talk to your wife in a more gentle way. Colossians chapter 3, verse 19. Husbands, love your wives and be gentle with them. Any fool can be selfish. Any fool can be rough. Any fool can be rude, but gentlemen are gentlemen. Now, this is true not only in marriage. The key, a great marriage is simply the union of two great forgivers. Because you're gonna hurt each other a lot in life. I've been married to Kay 38 years. I've hurt her so many times, and she's hurt me so many times, but we're both great forgivers. And that's part of gentleness. Now, it's not only a key to effective marriage. Gentleness, you're going to need this someday, is the key to effective parenting. Never discipline, I said, out of anger or out of frustration, but always gently out of love. Ephesians 6:4. Fathers, do not irritate your children. Do not provoke your children to anger. In other words, don't do things that make them intentionally upset. Do not exasperate your children to resentment. What does that mean? It means don't raise the standard so high there's no way they can meet it. You know, you ask for C's and you ask for, B's and they get C's. Then you ask for B's and they get B's. Then you ask for A's and you want straight A's. And you know, he said, don't exasperate your kids asking for perfection in their life, but rear them tenderly. In other words, gently. Rear them tenderly, gently in the training and in the discipline and in the counsel of the Lord. I can honestly say to you that I never remember my father ever raising his voice against me growing up. Not one time. Not one time. Did he ever get angry? Of course he did. Was he ever upset with me? Of course he was upset. Did I ever really blow it and have every reason for him to get angry? Many, many times. Almost a daily basis. But he was a gentle man. He had strength under control. And he would not yell at me. Gentleness communicates love. Number six, this is an important one. Gentleness earns respect. Gentleness earns respect. Proverbs 11, verse 16. Women, if you want to be respected as a woman, here's what the Bible says. A woman of gentle grace will be respected. A woman of gentle grace will be respected. That's also true of men. But you know, when I think of that verse, a woman of grace, gentle grace will be respected, I think of Mother Teresa. Mother Teresa was this little, I mean diminutive, barely, you know, I don't know, four and a half feet, maybe 5 feet tall at the most. I don't think she was even that tall. Quite frail, quite small, diminutive little Romanian nun. But she could walk into the United States Congress and put the fear of God in every power broker in that room. Why? Because gentleness earns respect. And she was earned that respect. Gentleness, by the way, is a prerequisite to leadership. If you want to be a leader in any area of life, you're going to have to learn what we're talking about tonight. If you want to be a leader in the church, if you want to be a leader in government, if you want to be a leader in business, if you want to be a leader in your home, if you want to be a leader in your community, in your school, or in any other organization, every great leader is a gentle leader. The greatest leaders of all time were the most gentle, Jesus being the supreme example. But for instance, the greatest president in our history was Abraham Lincoln. No one was more gentle than Abraham Lincoln. And he even showed gentleness in the way he treated the defeated southern states with respect and brought them back in a gentle way. If he hadn't been a gentleman, we would have a divided nation. Gandhi was a gentle person. Martin Luther King was a gentle person. George Washington was a gentleman. He was truly known as a gentleman. And great leaders are gentle. You know, there's a story in the Bible that you really ought to know about, and it's the story of a guy named Rehoboam. In the Bible, there was a guy named King David who united all 12 tribes of Israel, and they became one nation. And together, the 12 tribes became quite powerful. And they had a lot of land, and they were very strong. It was the apex of the power. David had a son named Solomon. Solomon expanded the empire of Israel and united the tribes even more. And they were at the greatest power at that point in history. They were the most powerful nation at that time. Solomon was the wisest man in the world. He was the wealthiest man in the world, and he was the most powerful man in the world. And he had this great united kingdom. And then Solomon dies, and he turns this enormous, huge kingdom to his young son named Rehoboam. Rehoboam had no experience in leadership at all. And so he starts by doing the right thing, and then he does the wrong thing. He starts by going to the older leaders of the nation. They are called the elders. And Rehoboam goes, said, look, I'm just a young guy. I don't know anything about leadership, and I'm thrust in this position. Would you guys tell me, what do I need to do to earn the respect of the nation and be the kind of leader my father, Solomon, and my grandfather, David, were? And he did the right thing. He listened, he went to the elders, the wise, and you should be listening to older men and older women in your life, listening to them always at every stage of your life. And the elders of the nation say to Rehoboam, I'll tell you what, if you'll just do two things, the people will follow you anywhere. First, if you genuinely serve them and you show that you're there to meet their needs. And second, if you always speak to them gently. Don't do a power surge. Don't do a power grab. Don't be on an ego trip. Speak to them gently. He said, these people will follow you anywhere. They'll be putty in your hands. They'll do whatever you ask them to do as leaders. Now, that's the good thing he did. The bad thing is he paid no attention to the advice of the elders. And so then he goes to all the young guys he grew up with, all of his peers, and he says, what do you guys think I should do? Now, they weren't any wiser than he was. They had no more experience than he did. So he says to his friends, young friends, what do you think I should do as the new leader of this nation? And the young men gave him the exact opposite advice. They said, you got to prove that you are in authority. You got to prove that you have the right to be king. You got to be tough. You got to be hard. You got to be demanding. You need to lay down the law right now and let everybody know that you're in charge. And you have to be unbending, and you need to prove, because you're young, you're going to need to prove that you are the authority and the leader. And that's exactly what he followed, that advice. You know what happened? The whole nation rebelled. They went into riots and chaos and eventually civil war, and 10 of the 12 tribes of Israel split from Rehoboam's kingdom and started a whole new kingdom, and that was the end of the united Israel. And from then on, they have no more power as a people. Why? Because Rehoboam refused to be gentle. It was just a stupid thing. Instead, he threw his weight around. Listen, anytime you have to stand up in front of a group of people and says, excuse me, everybody, in your business room, in a clubhouse, or in a boardroom, anytime you say, excuse me, I am the leader, if you have to tell the people you're a leader, you ain't. If you have to tell them, you're not it. He who thinketh he leadeth and hath no one following him is only taking a walk. So leadership is earned, it is learned, and it is discerned. It is never demanded. If you demand that you're the leader, you're not a leader, you're a dictator. And that's a big difference. There's a difference between being a boss and a leader. A leader leads by example and leads by influence. Now, gentleness earns respect. And the more gentle you are, the more respected you're going to be as a leader. The greatest leader in the Bible was, of course, Moses. Moses liberated the Israelites from 400 years of slavery. He took on the most powerful man in the world at that time, Pharaoh, let my people go. He had nothing but God on his side, and that was enough. And he was fearless, and he was unafraid to go speak truth to power. And yet, here's what the Bible says about Moses, the greatest leader in the Bible. Numbers chapter 12, verse 3. Moses was a very meek and gentle man. In fact, he was more gentle than anyone else on the face of the earth. This is why you can understand meekness is not weakness. Gentleness is not weakness. In the Bible, there are only two people in the entire Bible who are called meek or gentle. Only two in the entire Bible. You know who they are? Moses and Jesus. Neither of them were weak. Jesus knew how to call the shots and turn the tables upside down when he needed to, and turn over the money changers. And he had no problem being strong. He was strength under control. Now, here's the amazing thing. Moses is the only other man in the Bible called meek. And yet, do you know what Moses' persistent sin was? He had an anger management problem. Moses had a temper, a violent temper. In fact, it is Moses' temper that got him trouble throughout his entire life. One day, Moses got so mad, got so angry, he killed an Egyptian. He murdered a guy out of anger. That's pretty angry. Another time, God gave him the Ten Commandments up on Mount Sinai. He came down and he saw all of the people, and they were all having an orgy. And he got so angry at that, he throws down the Ten Commandments that God had made for him, and they break. And God says, "You're making the second set, buddy." It's true. And he had to go back up, and he had to carve personally the second set. God had given him the first set, but he broke them out of his anger. Another time God said, the people were thirsty. He said, "Well, I want you to speak to the rock and water will come out of it." He says, "No, Lord, we've always done it another way. I want to do it the traditional way." And he struck the rock. He got angry and struck the rock. It was anger that kept Moses out of the promised land. So he had a lifelong problem with anger. How would a guy who has a lifelong problem with anger be the only other guy in the Bible called gentle? Here's the reason, and this should give hope to you who struggle with anger management. Moses was teachable. And when people spoke to him about areas of his life that needed to be changing, he didn't get angry back at that. He learned from them. Now, you may have a struggle controlling your temper. The real issue is not that. The real issue is, are you teachable? And when somebody points out that you have a temper problem, do you humbly listen and respond with gentleness, or do you get mad at that too and have a hissy fit and a cow? Moses was meek because he was teachable. Now, there's number 7. Gentleness is a witness to unbelievers. Gentleness witnesses to unbelievers. When people look at you, and non-believers are watching you all the time, and they're watching to see, are you any different than they are when you're under stress? Are you any different than they are when you are under pressure? When you respond to pressure with gentleness, that is an incredible testimony to the world. Here's what the Bible says, Titus 3:2. Believers should never speak evil of anyone. Circle that. If you're a believer, not only am I as a pastor not to do that, you're not to do that. Believers should never speak evil of anyone. Does that mean you can't disagree with them? No, of course you can disagree with people. You just can't speak evil of them. You can't malign them. You can't slander them. You can't do personal attacks against them. Not if you claim to be a follower of Jesus, you can't. Believers should never speak evil of anyone, even the people who hurt you, even the people who hurt you. Nor be quarrelsome. You're not allowed to be quarrelsome. Instead, they should be gentle and show courtesy to everyone. Circle, be gentle and show courtesy. You, if you claim to be a follower of Jesus, you are not allowed to speak evil of anyone. You are not allowed to be quarrelsome. Instead, you must be gentle with everybody and you must show courtesy to everybody. That means even people of a different political party? Yes. You know, God gave me the gift of evangelism, which means I spend most of my time when I'm not at Saddleback speaking to people I totally disagree with. I disagree with what they believe, or I disagree with their lifestyle, I disagree with their concept or whatever, but my definition of evangelism is you cannot win your enemies to Christ. You can only win your friends. And to me, evangelism is you build a bridge of love between your heart and theirs, and Jesus walks across. Now, people aren't going to trust Jesus till first they trust you. People don't ask me, is the Bible credible? They want to know, are you credible? Rick Warren, are you credible? Are you exactly what you appear to be? Are you the real deal? Do you live with integrity? Are you gentle? Are you loving? Are you compassionate? If people like what they see, they will listen to what you say. But first, they've got to like what they see. Gentleness is a witness to unbelievers. We are to be gentle and show courtesy to everyone. Now, let me just tell you something. I know this from experience. If you actually obey this verse, you're going to be criticized by other Christians. Because they're going to tell you, they're going to say, you're compromising. You see, when I say, I have friends who are Muslims, and I have friends who are atheists, and I have friends who are gay, and I have friends who are secularists, and I have friends who are Mormon, and I have friends who are, you can name it, Democrats, Republicans, and in between. And you go, how could you do that? And they accuse you of being compromising. No, you don't compromise what you believe. You just treat everybody with respect. You treat everybody with courtesy, whether you agree with them or not. Does that make sense? And you are to do that. If you do, there will be people say, hey, you can't be nice to those liberal people. Well, why not? Because then you're a liberal. Or you can't be nice to those conservatives. Why? Because then you're a conservative. You've heard me say this many times before. People ask me, are you left wing or right wing? And I say, I'm for the whole bird. Okay? I'm actually for America. Have you ever seen a bird fly with one wing? If you only have one wing, you fly around in a circle. It actually takes both wings. Nobody gets it right all the time. Independents don't get it right all the time. Democrats don't get it right all the time. Republicans don't get it right all the time. I have friends who are Republicans. I have friends who are Democrats. I'm for my friends. Why? That's what Jesus would do. Because there's something more than politics that's important, and it is, do they know Jesus? And that's what we are to do. Gentleness is a witness to unbelievers. Look at this verse, 1 Peter 3:15. Always be prepared to give, he's talking about witnessing to an unbeliever. Always be prepared to give an answer to everybody who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have. But, he says, do this with gentleness and what? Respect. No matter what they believe and no matter how they act and no matter how ungodly they are, you are to do it with gentleness and respect. In other words, you don't go out thumping Bibles on people saying, turn or burn, you're going to die and fry while we go to the sky. That doesn't work. That doesn't work. Gentleness witnesses to unbelievers. Number eight, gentleness makes me like Jesus. Gentleness makes me like Jesus. And this is the biggest one of all. That's why I saved it for last. In Matthew chapter 11, verse 28, 29, it says, if you want to be like Jesus, you want to be a godly woman, a godly man, you're going to have to learn gentleness. Jesus says in Matthew 11, come to me. Come to me, all you who are weary and you're burdened, you're stressed out. And he says, I will give you more work to do. No, he doesn't say that. I will give you what? Rest. Yeah. Then he says, take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle. Circle that. God says, Jesus says, I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. Now, question number one, doesn't this mean that if I want to be like Jesus, I've got to learn to be gentle? Yes. Question number two, is it possible that the stress you're feeling in your life and the pressure you're feeling in your life is because you are not gentle? Yes. Because the Bible says the more gentle you become, the more Christ-like you become, and the more at peace you become, and the more at rest you become. The reason why you're stressed out all the time, why you're tired all the time, why you feel pressured all the time, is because you are not gentle. He says, I'm gentle, and if you come get with me, I'm going to give you rest and peace, not stress and pressure. You say, oh man, I want that. I want to be at peace. I want to be like Jesus. I don't want to be stressed out all the time. So I'm just going to go out, and tomorrow I'm going to force myself to be gentle. And so you get up in the morning, and you go out and go, and how are you today? And you, oh, just fine, thank you. And you, how are you today? No, that you can't fake gentleness. You can't manipulate gentleness. You can't manufacture gentleness. It's got to be an inside job. God has to produce it inside you. Look at the next verse. The fruit of the Spirit is what? Gentleness. It is God's Spirit producing it in you. You can't fake gentleness, because inside you're going to still be under stress. It is something that God does to you. There is a prayer that I've prayed now for over 30 years. I've prayed it almost every day. And as I walk out and I see people and I walk down the patio, I say, Lord, help me to treat people the way Jesus would. Why? Because I am not by nature a gentle person. I'm not. And you know what? Neither are you. You are not by nature a gentle person. You have to learn it. And you have to let God produce it in your life. God, help me to treat everybody I meet with like Jesus today. Not rude, not crude, not incivil in all of those ways. Now, let me wrap this up. Who could you practice gentleness with this week? All right, let's just get down and dirty, really practical. I'm going to give you three statements. Just write these down. They're not on your outline. Here's three things I want you to practice gentleness this week with three different kinds of people. Okay, so write these down. Number one, this next week, here's the first sentence. When someone serves me, be understanding, not demanding. When someone serves me, be understanding, not demanding. That's what gentleness is, strength under control. What are you talking about, Rick? I'm talking about waitresses when they serve you, clerks in stores when they serve you, a secretary or a government official or a clerk, or employees if you work, people work for you, or people in fast food. You know, a while back I went into McDonald's ordering my Daniel plan. Just seeing if you'd catch that or not. And I'm standing in line, and there was this young girl, very flustered. It was obvious she was a trainee at McDonald's. She was just like in her first day or first couple days, and she was pressured, and there was a long line, and she was making a lot of mistakes. And the more she made mistakes, the more people got upset, and they were not understanding. They were demanding, and the more demanding, the more pressured she felt. And I thought she was going to burst into tears. And when I came up to get my Daniel plan meal, I looked at her and I said, it's okay. It's not that big a deal. Don't worry about it. It's not anything for people to have to wait a few extra seconds. And tomorrow will be a whole new day. You're just learning. It's okay. And she looked up at me and she goes, aren't you that guy from Saddleback? I'm glad I was understanding, not demanding. And then I got to thinking, I wonder what is the reputation of our church family in Orange County when we go out for fast food? Are we understanding or are we demanding? I didn't get it the way I wanted. You know, I've traveled all the way around the world. I've been in 164 countries. And I want to tell you this. Americans have a simple reputation overseas. We're rude. Americans are thought of pushy, rude, incivil, not gentle, demanding, not understanding. Now, the secret of great service. You want to get great service at anywhere, restaurant or anywhere, plane or anything. Treat people with respect and be considerate of their feelings and be sympathetic and be understanding, not demanding. The Bible says in Philippians 2 this. Don't just think about your own affairs, but be interested in others too and what they're doing. Your attitude should be the same as that of Jesus Christ. So when people serve you this week, be understanding, not demanding. And if you don't get your burger right and it didn't come back animal style, that's also on the Daniel plan. Don't sweat it, all right? Okay, number two, write this one down. When somebody disagrees with me, this week, when somebody disagrees with me, be tender without surrender. Be tender without surrender. I'm not saying gentleness means you have to cave in on your convictions. And if somebody tells you something is wrong when you know it's right, or somebody tells you that something is right when you know that's not wrong, that's not right, it's wrong according to Scripture. You don't back down, you don't become wimpy, you don't become a chameleon and say, well, ever teach his own ways and that's your interpretation, wow, wow, wow. No, no, that's a cop out. But you can be tender without surrender. Some of my best friends are people who violently would disagree with me on what I believe about certain things. I don't compromise on what I believe. I know what the Bible says, and I'm not afraid, and I'm not ashamed, and I fear God's disapproval more than theirs. But I treat them with gentleness and respect. And that's why we can have a friendship. Let me show you a verse, Romans 14:1 in the paraphrase of the Message. I love this. Welcome with open arms fellow believers who don't see things the way you do. In other words, they may be another brand of Christian. They may be Pentecostal or Catholic or Presbyterian or Lutheran or Baptist or Calvary Chapel or Vineyard or, I don't really care. It just says, maybe they don't even agree with you on certain different things. Welcome with open arms fellow believers who don't see things the way you do. And don't jump all over them every time they do or say something you don't agree with. That's the exact opposite of what people are doing on the internet right now. They jump over everybody. Then he says, even when it seems that they're strong on their opinions but weak in the faith department. Remember, they have their own history to deal with. Treat them gently. That's being like Jesus. That's what God wants you to do, to treat everybody gently. You be tender without surrender when somebody disagrees with you. Would you write this down in your outline? I never get my point across by being cross. You can tweet that one too. This is a really tweetable sermon. I never get my point across by being cross. You don't have to devastate those you disagree with. A lot of people make verbal overkill to make a point, and they turn everything into win-lose. You have to decide, do I want to make a point or do I want to make a friend with that unbeliever or even another fellow Christian? All right, and then one more. Let me give you this one. When somebody disappoints you, and you're going to be disappointed this week, when someone disappoints me, be gentle, not judgmental. When somebody disappoints you this week, be gentle, not judgmental. Galatians 6:1 says this. If someone is caught in a sin, you who are spiritual should restore him gently. That may be somebody in your small group. You who are spiritual should restore him gently. But, it says, watch yourself or you may be tempted too. In other words, given the right situation, we're all potential sinners in any potential area. And we don't surprise ourselves. If somebody's caught in a sin, restore them gently. And Ephesians chapter 4, verse 32 says this. Be gentle with one another and sensitive with one another. Forgive one another as quickly and as thoroughly as God in Christ forgave you. We're going to come back to this verse in another week. It's saying this, God cut you a lot of slack. You better cut everybody else a lot of slack. God has shown you grace. You better show everybody else a lot of grace. God has forgiven you a whole lot more than you're going to have to ever forgive anybody else. That is gentleness. So how do you react when somebody really screws up their life? they really mess it up. And you go, I told you so. I could see it coming. Serves you right. I would have never been that dumb. And you actually get a secret satisfaction when you see somebody fall, particularly if they've criticized you. Do you know what angered Jesus the most? It wasn't sin that angered Jesus the most. What angered Jesus the most were self-righteous people who thought they spent all their time being God's appointed judge on earth of everybody else. And Jesus got really ticked off at those people. They were called the Pharisees. Happiness is when you can accept people who haven't attained your level of perfection. That was sarcasm if you didn't get it. This is what it means. All right, it's time to close. Let's bow our heads. Do you really want to be like Jesus? If you do, you're going to have to learn the third beatitude. God blesses those who are gentle. The whole world will belong to them. Why? Because they don't overreact and they're not out of control. It's strength under control. Would you pray this prayer in your heart? Dear Jesus Christ, I am not by nature a gentle person. I'm just not. And I need your spirit of power and love and self-control. And this week, when people serve me, help me to be understanding, not demanding. And this week, when people disagree with me, help me to be tender without surrender. And this week, when people disappoint me, help me to be gentle, not judgmental. Lord, I want to be like you. I want to have a gentle answer that turns away anger, not stirs it up. Help me to lower my voice when everybody else raises theirs. And when evil things are said about me, help me to respond like Paul, to respond gently, and disarm my critics. And when people are headstrong and I'm trying to persuade them, help me to remember that I'm never persuasive when I'm abrasive. But the more pleasant my words, the more persuasive I'll be. Lord, I want my life to be attractive. I want the beauty that comes from within, the unfading beauty of a gentle spirit, which is so precious to God. And Lord, help me to use gentleness this week to communicate love to those that I love in my life. Help me to be gentle with them. You said that gentleness earns respect, that a woman of gentle grace will be respected, then a godly man will be gentle. Lord, I want to be a gentle leader. I want to be meek like Moses and like Jesus, strength under control. I want my life to be a witness. And Lord, I ask you to help me to never speak evil of anyone, to not be quarrelsome, to show courtesy to everybody, regardless of what they believe or how they live. Help me to share my faith with gentleness and respect. Most of all, Jesus, you've promised that if I would come to you and team up with you because you're gentle, I would find rest for my soul. Replace my stress with your gentleness. I want the fruit of the Spirit to grow in my life. If you've never invited Jesus Christ in your life, say, Jesus Christ, put your Spirit in me beginning tonight. I want to follow you and love you and learn to trust you the rest of my life. I give my life to you, Jesus Christ. In your name I pray. Amen. God bless you, everybody.